The movement for Medicare for All gives us a once-in-a-lifetime, perhaps, opportunity to talk about what health care for all of us really means. And here to talk about one aspect of that discussion that I think is so important is Julia Bascom. And Julia has a long history in activism as well as writing. And so I'll just give you the highlights here. She is the executive director of the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network. She's also done organizing and activism work in her home state, New Hampshire, served on a number of councils there. She edited and contributed to a book called Loud Hands, Autistic People Speaking. It's an anthology of writing by autistic people, and I've gotten a lot out of reading it. And she also serves on the Disability Equality Index Advisory Board and a number of other advisory boards and groups as well. And she's been looking at this issue as well. So first of all, Julia, thanks for coming on the program.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
So let's jump right into it. What are long-term, you know, the debate is coming around the issue of what we call long-term support and services. What is that?
So long-term supports and services are just the services and supports for daily activities that disabled people need help with in order to live and work and be in our homes and communities. So some examples would be the personal attendant who helps your grandma get out of bed and get dressed and get started in the morning, the job coach for a young man with Down syndrome helping him learn new tasks at his job, the roommate who helps me stay focused and not walk into the street while I'm running errands, just people helping us go about and live our lives.
So really, if we think about healthcare as and medical care as helping us lead the fullest possible lives, it's really part of our healthcare. It's what it sounds like. So the people who get this, the recipients of, I guess we can call them LTSS, who would that be? It would be anybody who needs help?
Yes, it's a lot of people with developmental disabilities like me, so autistic people, people with intellectual disabilities, people with physical disabilities who don't have enough independent movement to do things by themselves, a lot of aging adults. It's pretty common to need more help as you age and you acquire disabilities, and people with mental health disabilities as well. I also should say that the preference in the disability community is to have a specific type of LTSS called home and community-based services. And those are services, just like in the name, that you get in your home and community as opposed to in a nursing home. Technically, when we talk about LTSS, we're also talking about things like nursing homes and other institutions. But there's a big preference for services in the community.
So this is just humane because this is...
Right.
Yeah, this is, you know, of course, if you can give somebody care in their home, around their family, their friends, familiar objects, things that make them comfortable, that's so much better than forcing them to go into an institution or someplace where they're not, that's not home, right? So
it's really a civil rights issue. Like, if you remember the folks, the protesters who got arrested in Mitch McConnell's office 2 years ago during the ACA repeal fight, those were disabled people who use home and community-based services and long-term supports and services, and they were protesting because that bill would have cut those services. It's really about, can I get outside? Can I live the life I want to live? Can I exercise my rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? It's really basic.
Right. Absolutely. I completely understand. So thank you for that clarification. So now we have this whole conversation about Medicare for All. I talked about it in my introduction that we have a debate about it going on. We have a movement for it. We have a new bill spearheaded by Representative Pramila Jayapal that covers a lot of things that have not been in previous proposals, except perhaps the Bernie Sanders Medicare for All proposal. But it's a pretty comprehensive bill. How does it do in terms of long-term supports and services? Is it, do you think it's an improvement over what's been proposed before? Do you think it goes far enough?
Yeah, I think it's a big improvement. Whenever we're talking about Medicare for All or universal health care, the disability community always gets excited but kind of wary because we know that Medicare as it exists right now doesn't actually cover LTSS. All of that is paid for through Medicaid. So we look at the bills. the last version of this bill just had sort of a sentence saying that Medicare for All would include home and community-based services, but not really any detail. And those details really matter to us because it's our lives. This version has been designed a lot more thoughtfully. There's a real attention to what do these words mean? How would that program be implemented? What would people's rights be? I think there's still a lot more to do, but it is a big improvement. It's also different from the Sanders bill in a couple of really important ways. The bill in the Senate right now that was introduced in the last Congress talks about LTSS, but it keeps it alone in the Medicaid program, which means that you have to qualify for Medicaid, which means you have to live in poverty in order to qualify for these services. There's still a very narrow set of services, and it segregates us out from everybody else. It sort of takes this program that provides for really vital needs and isolates it to just disabled people, which makes us really worried thinking about the future of the program. Having the Jayapal bill go further has been really helpful in pushing that conversation forward. And I should say that we're also having really productive conversations with Sanders staff about how we can bring those two bills into alignment going forward. So hopefully we'll be able to see both bills really move the needle forward.
Yeah, you know, what you're saying, Julia, is so important because the notion of separating out one category of person and having them come under a different administration process, in this case, one run by states versus federal government, and it creates vulnerability, right? It treats one group of people as if they're not the same as everybody else, so it creates a kind of discriminatory mentality that's contrary to civil rights mentality. And you know, I've felt for a long time that one of the problems with our healthcare system is that it separates people by their types of conditions and situations. And even, for example, you know, I'm mildly hearing impaired. That's treated differently than other forms of bodily impairment. You know, so we've got to have a system based on unification rather than separation. So I get exactly what you're saying. So what about Representative Jayapal's bill? Does you think it goes far enough? Are there still further improvements that could be made?
Yeah, no, I think all the healthcare bills that have been introduced have great things and then things that could use more thought. So, like, in terms of LTSS and the Jayapal bill, there are a couple of things I'm still keeping my eye on. One is the transition timeline. So the Jayapal bill would move us all over to Medicare for All in 2 years, which sounds great. But the frustrating reality is that folks with disabilities, and especially folks who use LTSS, are the folks who fall through the cracks. Like, we really live and die by tiny little details. Mm. And we just see over and over again that whenever you try to change the system that supports us, even if it's a small change, let alone a huge transformation, if you try to do it in 2 years, people die. It's really frustrating, but our lives are really dependent on infrastructure. Being able to exercise my rights requires some planning and some funding. So 2 years just isn't enough time. If you're trying to combine changes in payment with changes in the program, you probably need something more like 4 to 6 years, which I know no one wants to hear politically. Or you need to think through, is there a way to pay for everything we're doing right now, change the payment, and then change the program? They also, the Jayapal bill also uses global budgets, which for disabled people is basically just another word for block grant. We didn't like it when the Republicans were proposing it in 2017. We don't like it now. A global budget basically gives you, a healthcare provider, a set amount of money, right, to provide healthcare services. And the Jayapal bill explicitly says that home care agencies and other providers of services would also have these global budgets. And that's scary because disabled people are expensive, and sometimes, especially when people are living in the community, we have unexpected needs, and we need to make sure that our needs can always be met and that the provider's never going to have to say, well, I could serve you in the community, but now maybe you need a ventilator or something like that, and that's too expensive. I don't have money in my budget. You're going to have to go somewhere else. You're going to have to go in a nursing home. Yeah. There are fixes for that. There are relief mechanisms that can be built in, but we need to spend some time thinking through what those would be and how to implement them. And the last thing I would flag is just the eligibility criteria is still a little narrow. It kind of favors physical disability, and it's not going to work quite as well for people with cognitive disabilities, developmental disabilities, mental health disabilities. But all of these things are things that I think we can keep talking through and thinking through as we move forward in general, I think there are three different universal healthcare bills right now. They all have strengths and weaknesses. I'm really excited to see all three of them come out and get reintroduced this Congress so we can really have a robust discussion in this country about A, what healthcare is going to look like, and B, what LTSS looks like, how we support disabled people, what we can be doing better. I think there's still a lot of details to work out, but I'm excited to get started.
No, I think you're exactly right, Julia. I think that's such a great attitude to bring to this because I think it is exciting, and I tried to allude to that in my introduction. I do think this is a conversation we need to have. I think it's a chance for us to reinforce our understanding, for example, of what I also alluded to, how psychiatric and cognitive challenges are sometimes treated differently than the most obviously physical, or one kind of physical disability treated differently than another. And I was also, by the way, living in Berkeley, California, when, you know, the disability,
yeah, wow.
When that began, really, people started talking, in, at least in my awareness, many years ago, for the first time about making disabled people visible, making disabled people part of the conversation, understanding the needs of disabled people. And this, to me, is a chance to extend that as well, while we have this debate about Medicare for All. So I guess I would close with this. Where can people find out more about your work and about this issue and maybe get involved?
Sure. So there are, I think, three or four main things people can do. The first thing is they should read the bill and think about what they think about it, and they should read the other bills, the bill that Representative DeLauro is putting forth, the bill that Senator Sanders is putting forth, and just think about them, process that. One of our partners, the Center for Public Representation, has a really good website. It's medicaid.publicrep.org. And they have a really good entree point into what LTSS means and all sorts of different policy issues. And they have a whole page about the different health reform proposals in LTSS. So that's a good place to go if you want more information. In general, folks should reach out to local disability groups, whether those are like ARC chapters or Centers for Independent Living, state DD councils, and just make sure that local disability groups are involved in your health justice work and in your activism. That's a good way to make sure you're not missing anything. And finally, if you want to just go online, on Twitter, the hashtag CripTheVote is a really good way to find disabled people talking policy and politics online, including some folks in Berkeley, but just a lot of folks all across the country talking about a lot of different policy issues. And we talk about healthcare quite a bit.
Well, that sounds great. And by the way, I'm certainly going to check those things out. I would encourage listeners to as well. So, you know, I just say to folks, remember, this is a national conversation we're having. It's a chance to participate, learn, and share your own experiences, too. So Julia Bascom, Executive Director of the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network, thanks for your great work, and thanks for coming on the program and talking about this with us.
Thanks for having me.